This video will demonstrate the basics of testing, monitoring, and troubleshooting PI Buffer Subsystem version 4.3. A good place to start with this is to use Buffering Manager, the new GUI tool included with PI Buffer Subsystem version 4.3. Since I'm on my interface machine, I can open Buffering Manager by opening PI ICU and going to Tools Buffering. If you're on a non-interface machine, you can open Buffering Manager by using either the PI SDK utility or by using PI System Explorer. The important thing to understand about Buffering Manager is that there are three levels of counters and health statuses: the global level, the logical level, and the physical level. By default, Buffering Manager opens by showing the global level. The global level shows counters across all PI data archive servers configured for buffering. The logical level shows counters across PI data archive servers that are within the same PI data archive collective. And finally, the physical level shows counters for an individual physical PI data archive server. So for PI data archive servers that are not members of collectives, the logical and physical level will be the same. It's important to understand that the counters and health statuses get rolled up across the levels. So basically, at the global level, it's an aggregate of all of the health statuses and counters of all the levels underneath. So the first thing that you'll probably want to check in Buffering Manager is this global buffering status. The global buffering status shows the health status of all the PI data archive servers and all the levels underneath. So if any levels underneath have any warnings or errors, they get rolled up to the global level. So right now my state is healthy and I can see this green check mark. It's important to understand that a green check mark does not necessarily mean you're sending data. It just means that PI Buffer Subsystem is operating normally and is in a healthy state. So to check that I'm sending data, I'll want to use the counters underneath. So what do these counters mean? The first one is the estimated buffer capacity. So this is the estimated amount of time you would have before you start losing data if all the connections to the PI data archive servers was lost. So I can see that currently I have about 462.1 days of estimated buffer capacity. The second counter are the events in the queue. So this is, once again, a global counter. So basically, it's the events for all the PI data archive servers that are currently in the queue. So a healthy state for this would be either zero or few events. And it's normal to have events in the queue occasionally, as long as events are not continuously building. So here I can see my events in queue is hovering around 20 to 30, but it's never continuously building, and now it's flushed down to zero, so it's in a good state. Finally, we have the total events sent at the bottom, which basically counts the total number of events sent to all PI data archive servers since the start of PI Buffer Subsystem. So if PI Buffer Subsystem gets restarted, this counter gets reset back to zero. So once again, these are all counters and statuses at the global level, but if I wanted to, I could drill down to lower levels to see the status and counters for the lower levels. So the three ways to navigate between the levels are the top navigation bar. I can click this small arrow and then go down to the logical level from here. Or I can expand these drop-down arrows and see the levels underneath for the counters and statuses. Or I can use the server selection at the bottom. So these are all valid ways to navigate across the levels within Buffering Manager. So for example, I can go to my Carbon PI Data Archive Collective and see the counters just for it. Or I can go to individual members within the PI Data Archive Collective to see the counters for the physical server. Okay, one last note is that this estimated buffer capacity is going to be calculated based on the average bytes sent to the buffer in the last 10 minutes. And it's going to be a warning status if it's 7 days or less of estimated buffer capacity, an error if it's 24 hours or less, and critical if you're losing data or the disk is full. Okay, so this is really easy to see if you're on the local PI Buffer Subsystem machine itself, but what if you wanted to monitor PI Buffer Subsystem remotely or using PI points? So the way that you can do this is by using the provided Windows performance counters with PI Buffer Subsystem, which you can configure PI perfmon points for. So now that we have an understanding of the health statuses and the counters, let's demonstrate how to test buffering. So the easiest way to test buffering is by using a command line command, which is PIBufss-bc stop. So what bc stop does is it will simulate a disconnect from one of your PI Data Archive servers. And what that will do is it will demonstrate the behavior of buffering and queuing events locally on the server. So let's say I want to demonstrate using a bc stop on my PI Data Archive collective. So in the PI Data Archive collective, I can specify which member I want to do the bc stop on. So let's say I want to do it for the first server, which is my primary member. So now I've initiated the bc stop, and if I go back to Buffering Manager, I can see that the health status is now this yellow exclamation mark, meaning warning. So it says one or more warnings reported, and I can click the arrow to drill down and see where the warning is. So I can see the warning is with my PI Data Archive collective, and if I drill down further, I can see that it's with the primary member. Clicking on the primary member shows that the warning is user disabled data sending BC stop. And if I look at the counters now, I can see that I'm building events in the queue. So now I have about 650, now 709 events in the queue. And basically, it's going to continue building until I stop the BC stop command. So this is a good way to demonstrate the behavior of buffering and to test that buffering is working locally without needing to actually cause a network disruption or to shut down the PI Data Archive server. So once I initiate a BC start, that will flush the events in the queue and resume normal sending of events to the PI Data Archive server. So I'll just do the same command, but instead I'll do PIBufss-bc start and then specify the server I want to start for. And once I've started it, we can see that events flush pretty much immediately, and now I have zero events in the queue again. Okay, so next let's go through a couple error scenarios and how to troubleshoot with PI Buffer Subsystem. Alright, so I have Buffering Manager open, and the first thing I notice is that I have the yellow exclamation mark showing warning for the global buffering status. So drilling down within the global buffering status, I see that the warning is with my Graphite PI Data Archive server. So on this page, I can see the warning is there because I'm not connected to the server. And additionally, I can see that I have events building up in the queue, and I currently have about 1,204 events, and it continuously builds up. So I probably want to investigate why I can't connect to the server. So this might be due to maybe the PI Data Archive server just happens to be down, or maybe there's some kind of network disruption between this node and the PI Data Archive server, or there could be some other reason that's preventing PI Buffer Subsystem with connecting to that PI Data Archive server. So in this case, I know that recently I was doing some maintenance on the Graphite PI Data Archive server and I put it in standalone mode. So all I have to do is, because I've completed all the maintenance work, I can take it out of standalone mode. And once I've taken it out of standalone mode, it might take a little bit of time for PI Buffer Subsystem to reconnect. So I just need to wait for a couple minutes. And finally, I can see that PI Buffer Subsystem has successfully reconnected to Graphite, and I get the green check mark. And now the events have flushed from the queue, and it's back down to a low number or zero events in the queue. So in this case, I had standalone mode on my PI Data Archive server, but obviously there could be other reasons for losing connection to the PI Data Archive server. So some good things to check would be to make sure that the PI Data Archive server is running, that the network connection between the two machines is good, and that PI Buffer Subsystem is able to connect and authenticate on the PI Data Archive server. In this next troubleshooting scenario, I can see from Buffering Manager that I actually have an error this time for my global buffering status. So I drill down, and I can see that the error seems to be with my Carbon PI Data Archive collective, as both members have this error. So I'm going to drill down to one of the members, and I can see that the error is because I've received errors when posting to certain points. So I can click on the viewpoints and error to see which PI points are actually having this error. So I can see that the error is actually a no write access secure object. So it's actually a security error. And the point is point ID 23, or otherwise the random.int1 PI point. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up PySMT and check the security to make sure it's configured correctly for that PI point. So in PySMT, I'm going to search for that point. And once I have that point pulled up, let's check the security tab. So I have PI interfaces buffers, which is the identity of my PI buffer subsystem connection. And I can see that I'm missing the right permissions for this PI point. So I'm going to add that back in and then save the changes. So once I've saved the changes, let's go back to Buffering Manager. And we can see that Buffering Manager has now returned back to a good state. So those are just two example scenarios and what you might do to troubleshoot them with Buffering Manager. However, there are obviously other scenarios that could occur that would cause your PIBuffer subsystem to be in an unhealthy state. Another good resource for troubleshooting PIBuffer subsystem is the PyLive library. On the PyLive library, there's this troubleshoot buffering section, and underneath, there's a PIBuffer subsystem health alerts section. So this page basically shows examples of different warnings or error messages that you might see with PIBuffer subsystem and some troubleshooting steps that you might take to try and resolve them. So if after attempting to troubleshoot the issue yourself, and if you need assistance, you can always contact OSIsoft tech support. Before contacting OSIsoft tech support, however, it's a good idea to generate the buff report and send that as part of your tech support case. So the buff report can be generated by going to the PyHome64 directory, and it's located in the bin directory, and from here you can just run bufreport.bat. So what bufreport is basically it's useful information for troubleshooting PIBuffer subsystem issues, and includes information such as the software versions, the buffering configuration, the health status, and many other things that are useful for troubleshooting. So it can take a little bit of time to run, but once it's finished, you can see that it shows the output file and where you can find it. So I'm going to go to my temp directory, and I can see that the buff report was generated here. And now I can send this to tech support when I open my tech support case.